Sup, Gorehound here, and if you're wondering why the quality is kind of shitty now, it's because I'm not recording on my phone. It's pretty much dead right now, and it can only record 3 minutes at a time, as I said in my previous vlog. So, for the time being, this will be strictly a straight webcam upload, which I'm personally don't really. I really rather want to be using my phone, but this is probably I'm gonna be talking for a while, and this is probably gonna take longer than 3 minutes. So, yeah, Big Bad Wolves, Quentin Tarantino's best film of the year. Oh my God, where do I start with this? First of all, the film is definitely one of the strangest I've seen, meaning that it combines dark comedy and torture with pedophilia and rape. If that's a combination for anything, it shouldn't have worked, but it did, and I feel I don't know how I feel about that. I must applaud. I give major props to the directors and the writers for this, which I can't remember their name, but I'll be looking deep more into their works later. But yeah, this is not the kind of movie. If all right, let me just start this off. If you've seen the trailer, and the trailer is any indicator to that this movie is going to include torture in it, that's a given. But what the trailer does not show is how sick the sense of humor is in this movie. I mean, it's fiendishly dark. It's nothing like I've ever seen before. I mean, aside, the only movie that comes to mind is You're Next, and the only reason I don't like that movie more than this one is that this one, it for foreign release, it did not take 2 years to come out, first of all, and second, it wasn't a letdown. The movie had a budget, a relatively low budget, I think lower than You're Next. I don't know, I can confirm that. Let's just see this up. So, Big Bad Wolves. And look at this, check out the budget. Huh, budget hasn't been posted yet. Oh well. Anyway, it looks good, but I can tell not a lot of money has been put into it. And you can definitely tell that because it's primarily shot in one location. Not much of the outside is seen, so I'm guessing it made roughly around maybe a half million, 1.5 million US dollars, I'm guessing. I don't know. I'm just a guess. But is this movie worth the praise? I say yes. This movie is definitely one of the strangest combinations of topics to even be put into a feature-length film, especially one that's under almost 2 hours long. It runs a 150-minute mark. So how it manages to stay dark, have an edge to it, have a sub brings up the subtopic of pedophilia, rape, and murder, and on top of all that, include torture, brutal torture, I might add, even though it's kind of minimalistic, and really, really pitch dark humor. Like, I'll give an example. There's a scene where a guy, the guy in the chair in the movie, who's accused of pedophilia, and he's taken a blowtorch to the chest, and you see his like flesh like raw up, red and open, third degree burn, and burns to like a fucking like charred hole in his stomach. Well, not somebody's chest. But like you see it, like the camera doesn't move away. You see it like fester. And the guy's screaming, he's just like being gagged, he's just in pain. Then the people who are torturing him, they're like, "You smell this? This is wonderful. That smell reminds me of a nice barbecue." "You know what? I can smell this all day, honestly, because my wife made me vegetarian after because I am have high blood pressure, high cholesterol, so might as well enjoy it while I can." Stuff like that, where it just comes up out of the blue and just stuff happens, like male torture sequence, people get phone calls from their mom. Like, what? It's so offbeat, it becomes hilarious. I don't know. I wrote notes on my phone. I'm just gonna refer to it because I'm so lost trying to even talk about this movie. I throw on my phone. It's dark, grisly fun. It is dark, grisly fun because it's brutal. It's relentless, actually, considering the topics at hand. Pedophilia and rape are in a mainstream, well, not obviously mainstream, but in an independent film. Even for an independent film, you're kind of pushing the barrier a bit, because even for that is a tough topic. And it's borderline, like, if you are not okay with any of that, the sick material in the film, the topics that you want to bring up, you're probably not gonna like it. I mean, if you're coming in expecting like the next Saw or Hostel, you're gonna be disappointed. It's not that violent, but when it is, it gets there. Okay, I guess I've gone on for 7 minutes. I might as well discuss the plot of this movie. The plot of the film revolves around a cop. Three people. A cop who wants to get justice for like a pedophile. And the pedophile reportedly he kills the young girls he captures and rapes and murders. In the order that he's supposed to be taking care of the girls, like he kills them. He does it in a sequence where like he first like he lures them into seclusion, drugs them, rapes them, breaks their hands, and breaks in each individual finger. Then once they wake up from that, pull out their toes, pull out like their toenails, and well after that they will get their head and like decapitate on a rusty saw. I mean, it's sick shit. And it's very, very unforgiving. I mean, you don't see much of what this guy does. Most of it's set through dialogue, but you can get the gist of it. It's really nasty stuff. Now, but the cop, the now, one victim, it's introduced in the is pretty much brought up in the trailer. There's a third person. The third person is an internal affairs officer whose daughter was the most recent victim. Now, in the trailer that I saw, at least, he said that the daughter's head's missing and he wants to find out where the killer left it, or buried it at least. And the entire film revolves around the cop and the father, the internal affairs father, torturing the pedophile in trying to coerce a confession. That's the plot. It's very, very simplistic, but given the subject matter and how much you actually get to see of it, and you get to really see how far the guy's willing to go, because he is the father at least, because he is fucked up. Like, he had to see his little girl in a chair, decapitated, her panties, like, literally there's a shot of her le of this girl's legs, and you see it's her legs like this, and you see her panties like right like under like pulled down, visibly pulled down. It's from underneath the chair. Like, who does that? Shit. Anyway, the movie is dark as it is funny, and the funny bits do not really amount to much, but they don't detract from the plot either, which is interesting. But that may vary from viewer to viewer. What else did I write in here? Notes. Use of torture minimal. Yeah, I mean the use of torture in this film is actually really minimalistic. I mentioned that before. Really, the amount of torture in this film is there's not much to go on. Yeah, in the three act structure, the pedophile is beaten, without a doubt, beaten, but not much that it's excessive, like in Saw also, where it's like, yeah, this guy's gonna get like a ripped his chainsaw's leg off or something like shit like that. No, it actually stays very true and realistic. Like you get to see like when some guy breaks his finger, one guy breaks his finger, and he's like, and like you don't see anything like excessive from him for that. His fingers is broken, and then you just like you can see his hand like, ugh. You don't see. There's nothing excessive about it. I mean, what I'm trying to say is like they don't throw gore for the sake of gore. Like I mean, like if someone breaks a finger or something like that, you see like the bone pop out. The guy's bleeding out of like the open wound from the compound fracture or whatever. The film doesn't do that. It doesn't. It makes the pain feel real and come off as unapologetic because. Really, what the film is trying to play with, the film is actually trying to play with you. With its use of torture, it plays with the audience. And with it being very minimalistic and being that it's so varied, it gives the audience time to think. Because I'm going to get into major spoilers. Because in regards to the first middle half isn't really much of a spoiler as much as the trailer already kind of laid it out. But, where the spoilers truly lie or is in the final act. Because the final act is where really the shit hits the fan, and without a doubt, it provides one of the most bleakest and, depending how you view it, comical, dark, and upsetting ending to the film. Which caught me kind of off guard because I didn't really know what to feel because it was weird. It was like, well, okay. All right. Okay. So let's see what I got in here. All right. I wrote down what I thought, what the how torture worked in the end. It questions reality, the morality, in a very different way in a film most films cannot accomplish. Like a movie like a Saw or Hostel, like the morality is the bad guys are bad. But the throughout this film, the teacher or the pedophile is constantly proclaiming that he's innocent, and even though he looks innocent. He just by his character, his face, the way he acts, none of it's really even suggested that that he's a serial rapist murderer. Not really much. Except for one scene, and if you know the scene, you know. But aside from that one scene, he relatively keeps playing the innocent card. And to the point where you almost believe it. It's absolutely like, if it's one instance where like the playing down like the same joke, it comes not doesn't I'm not as bad analogy. It's like you're repeating to yourself that something is a lie. Something is not an absolute truth, but a lie at the same time. And you say it enough times in your head that you start to believe it. Your mind plays tricks on you, and you're starting to believe whatever lie or factual error that has occurred to be correct. And you start to believe that it's correct, and you forget in the back of your head that what you know is wrong. That's kind of what this film has going for it. And for it to its credit, it is frankly quite brilliant at that. And I've read in several interviews that the story and structure is much like a fairy tale, so I didn't see it too much. I saw it definitely because I definitely saw it as like a grim fairy tale, if it was supposed to be a grim fairy tale structure. If I'm related to any what I think is a very what not what I think, but to an actual like fairy tale like stories or series or whatever, it definitely reminds me of the Brothers Grimm, because probably this is probably something they would probably come up with if they really really wanted to step up their game. But I doubt that even in like the time they wrote like all their stories, they would probably incorporate their ch a child being brutally murdered, raped, and disposed of in the way that it does in this movie, and not in that order, but you get the idea. Anyway. What do I get? Yeah, I mean, I wrote this on my phone, so I'm just referring to the notes. It's like, for the shock value sharpens the narrative in which times purposely, or which at times is purposely vague to give the audience a glimpse of doubt and hope that all the torture is for naught. And that's what I mean by the teacher being, or the pedophile, being absolutely unrelenting on his believing, of his belief that he's innocent. Because it's like, he says it so many times that he actually believes it. And not only to himself, but to people around him. People can see, like, there are other people. People try to see through his facade, and people often can, and they probably do. Because through a plot point early on in the movie, a certain video leaks out of the police beating him, and beating him for the exact reason that he was suspecting being a pedophile serial killer, and everyone suspects him of being a pedophile serial killer. And he doesn't feel it that way. No one does. He loses his job for it. And the cop loses his job as well for an entirely different reason, being that he got caught beating the kid, beating up the suspect in a unjust and, to be honest, in a very unfair circumstance. So everything about this is questioning morality. How far are you willing to go to find the truth and break somebody? Like, mentally and physically, how bad do you have to physically maim somebody in order to, like, break their facade and like make them expose themselves. I've seen this done in a movie before. I think it was called Hard Candy. Hard Candy also dealt with the theme of pedophilia, but that movie was really, I'm sure, I haven't seen Hard Candy in a while. I saw it once, but I remember it left an impression where like Ellen Page was completely fucked, and because it was one of her first movies, and she was like 14, 13 when she made that movie, which was really like, oh fuck. But completely off topic. It's like another thing like that. The Hard Candy's entire plot was expose a pedophile, torture him to break his facade that he wasn't a pedophile, and then he finally gets to admit it at the end. But like this was just what the torture is supposed to do, and you're as the audience, you are getting that moral inclination or that sense of morality that. What if the guy's telling the truth? Is he really innocent? Now, for plot purposes, I won't say the ending, or for analysis purposes, I won't say the ending just yet, because I actually won't spoil the ending. Now, I think I may have subtly, but I might put that up as the tag. But there are, I really won't spoil this because the ending is quite what makes the film work. It's not just a finality or just a write-up, it's like, was this all for nothing? And if in the hands of someone more capable, would have a plan like that eventually succeed in actually working out in favor for the guys. I won't say what happens, but I'll just leave it at that because I think I talked about that enough. What else is going on? The thing. Well, I mean, I guess that's it. The film left quite an impression on me. It was actually well shot, very well directed. The opening sequence for this movie, like, dear God. I didn't really know what to expect from that because it really was like, well, essentially what the opening sequence is a game of hide and seek between like three kids, and one of the kids goes missing. Like just disappears and then title card done. It's an intense game of hide and seek, but it's not for laughs at all. So keep that in mind. Also, if you this film got a very, very limited release, like here in Canada, the biggest release that this film has gotten is on iTunes, and that's on the US side, not in Canada. Canada got, well, in Toronto at least, they have a theater, which one screening, mind you, and I went downtown to see it, which took about like 4 hours there and back, not counting the movie. No, actually, 2 hours there and back, not counting the movie. The movie was like 2 hours. It was like an hour, like hour 50 minutes. That's 5. Who cares? But the point is, you might not be able to see this film, and if you can't, I highly, highly recommend you watch it on demand or rent it on iTunes, because chances are you might get an odd theater experience like I did. The theater I went to, without saying any, won't label any of the names, but the theater that they chose to screen Big Bad Wolves was purposely small, like tiny, tiny. Like it was like at least maybe 150 seats for the entire room. The screen was relatively average. I guess. But the kicker was is that because it was a small and limited release, they put it in a really, really shitty back room. The one of those rooms, you know, like in a, you're probably in your average movie theater, you've went to the movie, you notice like one screen's like bigger than the other. Yeah, like kind of like that, but it's like little 150 seat little range. But the kicker is that there was kind of like this whirring sound in the background, and that really bothered me because the kind of like, and that wasn't even the projector, it was just something going in like industrial, like inside like an air shaft or something. It was really, really weird, and frankly, that it kind of sucked a little bit of the experience of it, but I'm glad I saw it because I can't rent it on iTunes, nor can I see it on demand. So I'm glad I saw it. In the circumstances, but chances are if you have it in your theater, just be kind of cautious because the film is not really made. Well, the film wants to make money, but it'll make its money more off the rentals on iTunes and on demand, more so in the theater. And your theater, you might get overcharged like I kind of did because I paid like $13 to see it. And frankly, for the same price, I can see it practically in like almost IMAX. Granted, it was the only showing that I had in the area. So, the fuck was I gonna do? I really wanted to see this movie. It was one of my anticipated releases of 2014. Second would be the Lego Movie, which I don't know about you, but that looks fun. I mean, that movie just looks stupidly fun. I don't know how to put that, but that's another movie I'm looking forward to. What else is I'm looking forward to? What else should I really? The Raid, obviously, that's for March, but I have honestly, I can't, I won't say any more how just excited I am to see Raid 2. But it'll be interesting to see how the month plays out and how 2014 brings out. But so far with Big Bad Wolves, it's a good start because look at this week's releases, like Devil's Due. What else crap is out right now? I know Devil's Due is out, and that was a piece of shit. Let's see. Ride Along, The Nutjob, like Father Like Son. Jack Ryan, Big Bad Wolves, obviously. Summer's in February. Honestly, I think Big Bad Wolves, for the horror crowd anyway, I think that's the choice that most people want to go for, or have the most interest in. Anyway, trailers that I got for the movie were actually I'm surprised actually, because considering I got there in the theater like at least 20 minutes early, I sat through the pre-show, and I hate pre-show, and I only got two trailers for this, which was interesting because A, because it was a really, really, really limited release, and two, I was expecting more indie stuff. And to granted, I did get some TIFF. I got one TIFF trailer, which was Rhymes for Young Ghouls. Rhymes for Young Ghouls looks good. I don't know half of what that plot is of the plot of the movie is about, but I will definitely see it when it comes out. It has officially no release date, I think, for a wide release date for theaters, but I knew it got some screen time on the Toronto International Film Festival. So if it is, I'll definitely keep an eye out for that because it's a Canadian movie and should come out sometime relatively soon. Unless it's like Your Next, it takes like 2 years to do, even though your movie's made for $1 million. Stuff happens. But I'll keep an eye out for that one. Another film that I saw on the trailer I saw was really kind of off because for the indie feel, I guess, it was Dawn Hemingway. Don Hemingway, look, Jude Law, I mean, I have no problem with Jude Law. He's a fine actor and all, but the character is weird. The character he portrays is like one of those like stock Don Hemingway looks like one of those stock movies where like the dad's all like shitty, he gets thrown in jail or some shit like that, and he has to be apologetic and make it up to his like make up to his family some way. It's one of those movies, so I don't like whole shell too much hope for it. But it had one shot in the trailer that I really liked. It was like it was a POV shot, not a POV, but like the camera was like in front of Jude Law. He was like, "I'm Don Weber," and he hits a car, and you see him like fly out, and as the car like flips, and you see like five people like fly out of the car because they're like in a convertible or something. That made me laugh a bit, but other than that, it looks incredibly stock. I mean, I wouldn't, I may watch it, maybe, but I don't shell out too much hope for that. And that's really all I got to say for that. Anyway, this is my first vlog for 2014, so let's see how the other months fare up, because I don't see any other January releases I'm looking forward to, because Big Bad Wolf was probably the top contender, and that one was pretty damn good. I cannot recommend that enough. But again, if it's not your movie, and if you're definitely not into the themes of it, and but you still kind of show that more little itty bitty curiosity, you should, in fact, probably see it. Man up, watch it. It's not as bad as the like IMDb says it is, but it is definitely something. Anyway, yeah, first vlog of 2014, 32 minutes. I gotta figure out some stuff how to, gotta figure out some way to make these significantly shorter. Anyway, this is Gorehound signing out, and if I ever find any other movies that I see in the theater or just interest me at all, I'll post about it here. Lego movie, maybe not too like horror disturbing related, but maybe just like fun, just to have a fun day. So maybe you'll see a vlog on that soon, but never know. Anyway, catch you guys next time.